All I have to say about that video is they told me to be bubbly and talk and act like Barbie, and I think I won the Academy Award. I don't know if you guys saw the movie, but I nailed Barbie. So as a business owner, most of you guys are that, you have to wonder, how the heck did a movie about Barbie become such a blockbuster? And how, as a business owner, can I replicate that success in my business? So, y'all, the Barbie movie success puts it among the top 20 top grossing films of all time. Barbie brought close to $1.3 billion at the worldwide box office, and it became one of the only female-dominated movies to be a top grossing film of all time. And that's with their core audience being just the girls in the room. So in researching for this talk, I read many articles about Barbie. There was articles in Forbes, the New York Times, Yale, Elle Magazine, even Psychology Today chimed in. In almost all of the articles, the pre-release hype and the marketing, which included collaborations with over 100 products, and their early teaser releases were given the credit for making it such a great success. Well, the fact that Barbie has 99% brand recognition in the whole world didn't hardly hurt. And my expert opinion is that having Ryan Gosling as Ken didn't hurt him either. And for the guys, I think they probably enjoyed seeing Margot Robbie. So in my research, I looked up some marketing lessons from Barbie for us to use in our companies. And this isn't according to Sandy. This is according to Forbes magazine. So according to Forbes, marketing lessons learned from Barbie. One, master the art of anticipation, teaser campaigns, social media. Two, strategize brilliant brand collaborations. There were 100 different brands that tagged on with Barbie. I'm not sure exactly how we do that in our companies in Wilmington, but I think the marketing gurus in the audience can help. Three, create immersive real-life experience for your clients. They will then turn around and sell your product for you. This Barbie and her daughter both bought pink shirts, took a picture at the movie, and posted it on social media. Embrace bold polarization. The film's clear identification of its ideal audience, women, sparked debates and discussion and added fuel to the marketing. So, heck, I mean, the Barbie trailer promised, if you love Barbie, the movie's for you. If you hate Barbie, the movie's for you. Who advertises that you can both love and hate a product but still consume it? Well, it happened. So, as you all know, I work at First National Bank, and everything, you saw that on the video, and everything is wonderful and perfect in Barbie world. And that is the kind of experience that you can expect when banking with First National Bank. And don't tell anybody, but I hear that Barbie and Ken both bank at First National Bank. So y'all, please come see us for any of your banking needs. Now I want to turn the meeting over to my friend, Pam Barbie Hardy.
Good evening, everyone. It brings me great joy to introduce the recipient of the Wilmington Chamber of Commerce Lifetime Achievement in Business Award, presented by Duke Energy. This award celebrates the outstanding contributions of area business leaders who have demonstrated long-term, active, and innovative engagement in their fields. The recipients of this award are not only successful within their companies and industries, but also deeply involved in their communities. Their positive influence has paved the way for future leaders and serves as a beacon of inspiration for generations to come. Tonight, we are privileged to honor Ms. Wilma Daniels. Please join us in watching a video that offers a glimpse into her remarkable journey and contributions. I present to you the 2024 Wilmington Chamber of Commerce Lifetime Achievement and Business Award, Ms. William Wilma Daniels.
It's other than everything maybe.
They didn't win from me.
Remember me, so I don't do the end. I don't do the end.
That purse didn't do it all. I think.
Yeah, Aaron, it is really sweet, but let the beauty from that breeze kind of said that my outlook is for you and your other one. The series, you look, that's about the worst kind of release is for long as it was.
Aaron, wait a minute, is it out of a port to put up a
It went on with Charlie Gray, that I come in. Just, why did they do me? I
tell me, because the story I have, Charlie.
This is a lot for me. It is a privilege and an honor to receive this prestigious award. I would like to express my appreciation to those that were involved in the decision-making process. First of all, I would like to thank God, who is the head of my life. Without him, I could do nothing. My friends think I do too much, I need to rest, but it's in me. I have to do what I have to do. I want to take this opportunity to thank the Wilmington Chamber, Natalie, and your committee for choosing me for this award. I'd like to thank Duke Energy for your support and relationship with the chamber that you have. I want to thank my family for their support. There have been many times that my family wanted me to come to Raleigh. Mama, come and go to Raleigh with us. Be planning this. I said, I got to check my calendar first. And then I said, I've got to see if I can come. I've got to just work things out. And they said, well, Mama, who you got to ask? You your own boss. But you know, once I'm committed to doing something, I have to do it. Family, I do love you for your support. I love all of you. Thank you. And I want to thank the boards that I've served on. I want to thank the nonprofit organizations. I want to thank the schools, the colleges, and everybody for just allowing me to share my ideas and just allowing me to be a part of them. I just want to share one thing with you. My dad was the one that taught me how to give at a very, very young age. But then when my husband passed away, it was like something totally different came over me. I felt like I could not do enough for Wilmington. I could not do enough for the people of Wilmington. I personally, it's been an awesome experience and a journey, but I love people. And you learn, the more organizations you take a part of, you learn a lot, you share a lot. Networking is good for us all. Relationships is good. And I just want to leave this with you. Knowledge is power. Embrace your challenges. Make a difference in your city. Give back to those that are less fortunate to you than you. And let's make Wilmington the best place, the best city that anyone would ever want to live in. I know that I need to rest sometimes, and I don't really take the time that I need. That's coming up. That's coming forth. But I just want to say, if there's anything that I can do to make Wilmington a better place to live, I'm ready to do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
I want to take a moment and recognize the past chairs who are here tonight in attendance. Charlie Maddox, Hal Kitchen, Mitch Lamb, Neil Andrew, Ricky Godwin, and for me, there's a really special one, Jim Lanier, who is my father-in-law. If y'all join me in a round of applause. Being the chair of the Wellington Board, the chamber of Wellington, is a big job, and it's been a pleasure for me in 2023 to do that. So another round of applause for Wilma Daniel as well. Wilma has been a friend and a mentor that I've gotten to know in the past year, and I'm just so excited that we got to honor you tonight. So I want to take a moment a little bit about the theme that we did tonight. Wasn't the Barbie car really fun? Yes? Yes? So Barbie has always had this like keen eye for real estate. If you didn't know, she has a dream house. Yes, you know she has a dream house. So it's in Malibu. And if I was born in 1962, I would have told her to put it in southeastern North Carolina. It would have been a good spot, right? But she didn't. And do you know that they told her, Mattel at least told her, to tear it down in the 70s? And they told her to put a bohemian townhouse. Weird choice, right? And then in the 1990s, they said, let's do a mansion kind of style, right? Like a 1990s dream house, and that's what they have now. But we're not here to talk about Barbie's dream house. We're here to talk about 2023 and the Wilmington Chamber of Commerce and what happened with us. And we've already heard from Wilma Daniels. We've already heard about a lot of visionary folks with the chamber in the past. And I want to tell you a little bit about Estelle Lee. So if you don't know the history, she gifted us the land that the chamber sits on a few decades ago. And this past year, we were able to complete a real estate transfer. And so now the Wilmington Chamber of Commerce is freed up to dream about our future and what we can do with our real estate. So you will hear about that in the coming year. And we're going to have a committee. We're going to do a full, complete study of what is possible for us to do with our real estate, because we're on the beautiful Cape Fear River. And maybe a few decades ago, it seemed like an unusual spot, but now it's a wonderful spot. So that's happened in 2023. Another thing that's happened is that our staff has grown. So maybe you have noticed that we have a few new faces around here. And I think so often when you see a nonprofit, you see somebody who's on the board of directors who's standing on a stage, and it's tempting to think that we do a lot of the work. But if you've been around the nonprofit world, you know that that's not really true. It's the staff that's doing a lot of the work, and I see a lot of them in the back. And I just want you to know that they are so professional. They're so passionate. Many of them have special accreditations, special certifications, and I just want to give them a round of applause for the work that they're doing. So thank you, guys. If I had a spotlight, I would hear from all of you, but I know that you would like not love that. So, but we really appreciate you for all of the hard work that you're doing, and you're going to see that in the coming year and years to come, all of the growth that's happening. We really, at the Chamber, have a very collaborative mindset. We really want to welcome you as members to join us at all the events, to bring us your ideas. We really, really want to support you in all that you're doing. So you heard in the Barbie video that we are really excited about the Wilmington, or about the Women's Business Owners Council. So sometimes we call it the WBOC, and that started this year. And it's something that I've wanted us to do for a really long time. And our first few meetings looked a little bit like a business casual Barbie party, like we were in our work outfits, but there were lots of hugs and lots of compliments because a lot of us women wanted to get together and really support each other. But what we saw missing in the business ecosystem was something for women who owned businesses. So not just a networking event, not just like a mentorship leadership thing, but for women who are owning businesses. And so we've finally started it, and we felt like the Chamber was a great home for that. So we're really excited that that has gotten off the ground. If you're a member, then we'd really love to hear from you. If you're a woman who owns a business, we would love for you to join us. And so it's just beginning. We're still trying to figure out exactly what it's going to look like, but we have about 50 women who have already joined, and it has been fantastic. So we hope that you will think about joining us. There have been so many other things that have happened in 2023, which you're going to hear a little bit more about that. But I'm going to tell you about how this all started before I introduce our speaker. So in 2012, I drove into the parking lot of the Chamber of Commerce. And I don't know about you guys, but have you ever had trouble finding the front door at the Chamber? Yes? It's not just me, right? So the first time I get to the Chamber of Commerce, I go in the door and I walk around because I'm in the stairwell. Do you know that door? It's like right by the parking lot. Okay, and so then I go to another door that's now like it's offices. And so then I go around to the riverfront area. Do you know where the double doors are? But do you know what happens there? They're reflective glass. So the people inside can see you, but you don't know that they can see you. So the wind is blowing and I'm kind of checking my hair. And people inside can see me, but I don't know this yet. And so I'm a newbie. Anyway, so finally I find the right doors and I walk in and guess where I am? Leadership Wilmington. You're my Craig Snow. I love you. That's my guy. We were in the same class together. So it was class of 2012, 2013, and I walk in and I finally find my classmates. And I didn't know Craig at the time, but of course I got to know him. And so I walk in, I don't know anyone in Leadership Wilmington, I don't know anyone at the Chamber, because my past 2.5 years I've been a stay-at-home mom, and before that, my background is in mental health and in the nonprofit world. I have a master's degree in social work, my undergrad is in psychology. So I don't have any business network, I have to start from the ground up. But my Leadership Wilmington program was the front door to the Chamber, and the Chamber was the front door to my business career. And literally, my business would not be what it is today without the Chamber. And I can't imagine what my life would be like without it either. And so whether you use Leadership Wilmington or one of the councils or this event or any kind of entrance into the Chamber world, I want you to know that we are here to serve you and to support you. And there are so many different pathways forward. And my class, my Leadership Wilmington class, was this wonderful way to get connected to the Wilmington community. And so I just want to leave this year and all the years that I've been involved with the executive committee by saying thank you. I have to say thank you to Charlie Maddox, who appointed me to the board of directors in 2017. Thank you, wherever you are, can't see you. But thank you to Charlie and to John Elliott, who believed in me and put me on the executive committee. I was a little bit resistant because, I mean, just to be completely honest, I didn't see a lot of almost 40-year-old women who own tiny businesses, because at the time I just had a really small team. But it's really important to see yourself and role models, and if you don't see the role model that you want to see, maybe you need to be it. Representation is really important. And so I love that our chamber is thinking in new ways, is bringing different councils forward, is really trying to serve our members, because you guys are the reason that we're here. You're the heartbeat of everything that we do. We have over 1,000 members. We represent so many different employers. We want economic prosperity for everyone in our region, not just our city, not just our county, not just our community, but our full region. So thank you so much for this opportunity. It's been wonderful. You are gonna absolutely love Lisa Leek, who is already the chair of this chamber in 2024. She is absolutely charismatic and passionate and a dear friend. And so before we get to know her, we are gonna hear from our speaker. So let me introduce him. It's my privilege to introduce our distinguished keynote speaker, Steve Lurch. Throughout his career, Steve has been a pioneer in the fields of marketing, consumer behavior, innovation, and leadership. During his 9-year tenure at Google, he's collaborated closely with major consumer electronic giants like GoPro, OtterBox, and Roku, shaping their digital strategies and spearheading groundbreaking marketing campaigns. So tonight, I'm going to ask you to listen to his insights on inspiring our teams to think more creatively. So I am now going to introduce Steve Lurch. Here he is.
Good, awesome. Can people hear me? Yeah, awesome. First big obstacle out of that. Well, good evening, everybody. I think my clicker out. Thank you all. Exciting to be here with you all in what I imagine, I hope, is a very exciting time to be a business leader in Wilmington, North Carolina. I've learned about and reading about the Hanover Endowment, or Hanover Community Endowment, am I getting that right? They have exciting new opportunities and changes, but even beyond that, globally, nationally, for business leaders with new technologies and artificial intelligence and COVID hopefully, permanently, finally, in the rearview mirror. So many new things, so many changes, so many exciting opportunities. But it creates a really big challenge, in my mind, for everyone in this room, for every business leader in the world, and certainly in this community. And that's that with all this change, with the world changing faster than it ever has before, it is harder than ever before to look into the future and to try and figure out what's coming next. To try to figure out where we as individuals, as teams, as businesses, where we should go, but also where can we go? What's possible for all of us? And that's what I want to start our conversation about innovation about today. I want to talk to you all about the future. I want to talk about what's possible. And I want to learn what you all think about it. So I'm going to start our conversation by asking you all a question. And this is going to be the easiest question I ask, so I expect many people to yell at the answer. Thinking about the future, thinking about what's possible, what's the name of this spaceship? Everybody, the Millennium Falcon. Awesome. Okay, everybody knows the Millennium Falcon. Does anybody know how fast the Millennium Falcon did the Kessel Run? 28? That's not right. I'm sorry. Technically, it's under 12 parsecs, but I'll accept 12 parsecs. So there are some nerds in the room, but not as many nerds as some other environments I've been. So I'll take it. Because this is the Millennium Falcon. It is a very fast spaceship that exists in a galaxy far, far away. And like every spaceship and every science fiction story I've ever heard, it has the ability, this futuristic technology, this great invention someone must have had, to flip a switch. Han Solo says, punch it, Chewie, and it does this. It jumps into light speed. Or they might call it warp speed in some other franchise, some other story, right? I think what they're talking about when they say light speed is that this spaceship is now traveling at the speed of light, right? That's a pretty logical conclusion. A little harder question. Anybody know how fast the speed of light is? Usually I get one or two. What was it? I can't even hear what everybody's saying, so I'm just going to tell you. It's 670 million miles per hour. 670 million miles per hour. Okay, and this is what's possible in the Star Wars universe and in a lot of science fiction universes. So, question for everybody. Show of hands. Who thinks one day, through invention after discovery and artificial intelligence and new computing powers, that one day this could be possible? 10 years in the future or 10,000 years in the future, will humans one day have the ability to create vehicles that travel at the speed of light? Who thinks that's possible? One day. All right, I'm going to say a quarter of the hands. All right, got some believers. We talk about Star Wars, only fair we have to talk about Star Trek. In Star Trek, they have light speed, but they also travel around via teleport, all right? You stand on your platform, you say, beam me up, Scotty. I don't really know how this works. They zap you with lasers or something. It takes apart your molecules and sends them through the airwaves, and suddenly you're on a different planet, on a different spaceship. This was a little hard thing. But who thinks one day, again, it could be 10,000, it could be a million years in the future, one day will humans figure this out? Who thinks that's possible? All right, I think we lost a couple of people. But we still got, that was still pretty good. I'm going to say about 1/6, 1/7 of them are on board with me. Last one. My favorite science fiction movie of all time. Loosely science fiction. I think I heard somebody say it before I answered the slide. Back future. Now this one, I don't understand teleporters. Time machines are simple. It's obvious. You get your DeLorean. You get your flux capacitor. You get your 1.21 gigawatts of electricity. You drive your 86 miles per hour. Poof. Right, you're 30 years in the future, you're 20 years in the past. Last big question, show of hands. I usually lose a lot of people for this one. One day, however far in the future, is this possible? Who thinks it's possible? All right, we got about 30 of you. So we lost most of you. Let's say we had 30 people left by the time we got the time. That's fine. Now we're going to do something different. Instead of looking at the future, talking about future innovation, let's go backwards. I read it, and again, this, right, this is like the 157th of these meetings, the 157th annual meeting for the Wilmington, North Carolina Chamber of Commerce. That means this went back to, I think, roughly 1867, I believe, would have been the first year of these meetings. Imagine you came to that meeting, which is three generations ago. It's not that long ago in human history. And imagine they had a speaker up on the stage who was talking about innovation. And he couldn't talk about Star Wars, and he couldn't talk about Star Trek, because it didn't exist in 1867. So instead, the speaker on the stage said, okay, I want to see a show of hands. Who thinks one day this will be possible? And the speaker went on to describe to you all, oh, not too fast, went on to describe to you all TikTok, right? They said, I have this object, I can hold it in my hand, it's about the size of my hand, I can aim it at my face, I can do a stupid dance, and in an instant, millions of people in China and Australia and Europe will be able to see my stupid dance. And I can simultaneously watch the stupid dances of millions of other people, tens of millions of stupid dances all at once I can consume on this object the size of my hand. And at that first Chamber of Wilmington Chamber of Commerce meeting in 1867, how many hands do you think would go up and say, who thinks that's possible? It's zero, right? It's zero. They would burn me at the stakes for being a witch. That's three generations ago. I was going to put this in Congress and kind of where I did my reveal. Just to put you in context of where we were technology in 1867, that's the year we invented the paperclip. So we just cracked the paperclip. We were still 1 year away as a species of humans. We're still 1 year short of cracking the technology of the paper bag, but we were almost there. So yeah, I think nobody in the room probably thinks TikTok's possible when everybody at their table is still looking at paperclips being like, oh my God, we are just cutting edge here with this paperclip. That's what I love about innovation. It's simply this embracing of this concept that if we don't know, and we can't know, what's possible or what's impossible. And we kind of have to move forward accepting the reality that anything is possible, that everything is possible. And when we talk about innovation, it's not just this big crazy stuff. It's not just inventions, it's not businesses and industries. It's everything. It's everything we do. It's our products, it's our processes, it's our people. I worked at Google for 10 years. I taught innovation and strategic planning at Google for 10 years. And I continue to do it now as a consultant and a speaker talking about innovation. And I can tell you that even at a company like Google that has all the money in the world and all the engineers in the world and all the code and all the robots and all the algorithms, the most impactful innovations I ever saw, the most impactful innovations at that company never started with big, grand engineering programs. It never started with code. It never started with data. It started with people asking very simple, critical questions about the way we conduct our business. Questioning everything. From the way we send emails, to the way we hold meetings, to the way we hire people, the way we do accounting, constantly ask, is there a better way? Is there a different way? Is there a new way, a faster way, a more efficient way? It was those tiny little changes, those tiny little innovations, those baby steps forward that lead to the bigger step and the bigger step and the next idea and the next idea and to the time machine and the teleporter. So that's what I want to talk to you all about today. I want to talk to you about three principles of innovation that we embrace at Google, three innovation principles that we ask all of our leaders to try and instill in our teams, to try to embrace new ideas, to try to embrace change, to talk critically about the way we do things. So we're talking about three things tonight. I'm going to tell you some stories from Google and from some other innovative companies. We're talking about how we look for innovation everywhere, prioritizing iteration and feedback, and fueling curiosity and passion. These are things we talked about all the time at Google that we really actively worked hard to accomplish. So the first one, look for innovation everywhere. This one's going to sound super obvious, but it is so much harder than you think. When people used to come to Google, I had one of my many sort of side gigs. I worked in an organization, as we call it the Executive Briefing Center. So when we have Fortune 100 companies come to Google, we'd wine and dine them and have these big fancy meetings, we'd give them presentations. I got to be a part of that program. So the CEO of Nike comes in, or the CMO of Apple comes in. One of the most common requests we got at those meetings was, we want to get a presentation from Google's innovation team. We want to hear from the chief innovation officer of Google. How does Google do this? We didn't have any of those things. There's no innovation team at Google. There's no chief innovation officer. Because it was made very clear to us on day one that innovation was everyone's job. It was everyone's job to think of new ideas and crazy ideas and outside-the-box ideas, ideas that had nothing to do with you, nothing to do with your team, nothing to do with your job. That was everyone's job. It was the expectation. And I've seen a lot of companies do that in different ways and bring that to life in different ways. It's not easy. It's not easy to source the many ideas that already exist out there. There's a million reasons, believe it or not, why people don't want to come forward with new ideas. Why your youngest employees, your most junior employees, why they don't want to share the crazy things they're thinking or the weird questions they might have. There's a story about a guy named Richard Bonnes. He was the son of two Mexican immigrants. He lived in a small labor community outside of Los Angeles when he was a kid. His whole family grew up picking grapes. He was one of 10 siblings. In the 70s, Richard Bonnes dropped out of high school, never really learned that well to speak or write English. School was hard, he dropped out. And he was able to get a job, I think around when he was 18, as a janitor at a Frito-Lay factory. This was like, paid three times what he got paid picking grapes. It was a great job to be a janitor. Then one day in the early 80s, Frito-Lay was not doing very well. Frito-Lay CEO decides, you know what, I need help. You know what? We're not doing well enough. The CEO, Frito-Lay, recorded a video of himself. And in that video, he simply said, "Hey, employees, I need your help. I want you all to feel like owners of this company. I want you to feel responsible for its successes and its failures. I want you to bring all of yourself to work. I want you to take ownership of what we do." Richard Montanez, the uneducated factory janitor at Frito-Lay, saw the video, as did all the employees. He didn't know it was weird for a factory janitor to pick up the phone and call the CEO of a Fortune 500 company. So that's what he did. He called the CEO of Frito-Lay, gets a hold of the secretary. Secretary puts him right up through to the CEO, and Richard says, "Hey, CEO, saw your video, and I've got an idea. I've got my idea. I'm the factory janitor out of the plant near Los Angeles. I've got a plan." CEO, "Awesome. I'm actually going to be out in the California area in a couple months. Why don't you put together a pitch? Come pitch it to me and my team." Richard goes home, he goes to the library, he rents a book on marketing, and memorizes a few sentences he wants to say during his pitch. He buys 100 little plastic bags and doodles on them the logo he invented, and then he invents a snack food product because he thinks, his idea, is that Frito-Lay doesn't have products that speak to his Hispanic heritage and to the taste buds of him and his family. He goes in and pitches it to the CEO, and today we have Flaming Hot Cheetos, which Adam Week will tell you is the most popular snack food in America for the last 3 years in a row. Tens of billions of dollars in revenue. Awesome story. Richard Montanez, really inspiring figure. He became an executive vice president at PepsiCo. But the thing to not get lost in that story is what the CEO of a Fortune 500 company did. When he recorded a video saying, "Hey, I don't have all the answers. Do you have any ideas?" And then when a factory janitor called him and said he had an idea, he said, "Great. I will take that as seriously as any other idea, because ideas are currency, and they don't matter where they come from. If you got an idea, I want it, and I want to hear it." Innovation comes from everywhere. It doesn't happen if we don't make it happen. Ideas don't come to us if we don't go ask for them. Ideas don't come to us if we don't make it clear to everyone we know and everyone we work with that we will listen, that we are eager for new ideas, for outside-the-box thinking. One of my other favorite stories of this, a real simple story, Jeff Bezos. Amazon launched, I think, in 1994, selling books. I think most people know that. After it sold books for a year or so, it started all selling movies and music, because it could be packaged very similar to books. So we're selling three things: books, movies, and music. And now it's 1997, and Jeff Bezos says, "I think we should sell a fourth thing. I want to do a fourth category." But he doesn't know what it should be. He writes an email, and he sends it to 1,000 customers. Sends an email to 1,000 Amazon customers, and he says, "What do you wish you could buy on Amazon?" He gets a lot of responses. He goes through the responses. He reads through 1,000, well, probably didn't get a response from everybody. Reads through hundreds of emails. And there's one answer that always stood out to him, because he said there's one answer that he felt represented the other emails. One guy said, "Oh, what do I wish I could buy at Amazon? Windshield wiper fluid. Because right now my car needs more windshield wiper fluid." That was it. That was the email. That silly little innocuous comment of windshield wiper fluid rang a bell in Jeff Bezos' head. That e-commerce about the thing, it's about the moment you're in. The benefit of e-commerce, the benefit of Amazon, of what we do and what we could do, is delivering people's needs in their moment of need. We should sell everything. By asking a question to 1,000 people and having one of them say windshield wiper fluid, Jeff Bezos realized he could turn Amazon into one of the biggest companies in the world. He asked for ideas, he took them seriously, and it's not like he got the idea, but what he got triggered the idea in him. He asked for help, he asked for innovation. Innovation comes from anywhere, but again, it doesn't just happen. You have to go make it happen. Second principle of innovation, this is my favorite one. Talked about this all the time at Google, I still use this all the time in my work. Prioritize iteration and feedback. At Google, we sort of looked at this as two concepts and two ideas. And the first idea always makes me think of the Google homepage. This is the first ever Google homepage. This is what Google looked like in 1998. If you don't remember that, Google is about 25 years old right now. Not very old. This is what the first ever Google homepage looked like. If you didn't remember, Google used to have an exclamation point in the title. They got rid of that. A little cleaner now. But the first idea of this prioritized iteration feedback is simply to say that everything you do as an individual, you should think of it as version one. Everything is version one. No matter how good your thing is, your product, your process, whatever, assume that someday there should be and needs to be a version 10. Because as time changes, we will have to get better. First ever Google homepage, if you look under the search bar, it says index contains 25 million pages, soon to be much better. Now I imagine that in 1998, having a search engine that could almost instantly organize 25 million web pages, that was probably a pretty big deal. It was probably pretty scientifically amazing. But right there on the front and center of their one and only product, they said, soon to be much bigger. They said, this is version one. This might be the greatest technology the world has ever seen, and we are committing to the idea that this has to get bigger, it has to get better, and we will do that. Does anyone want to guess how many pages are in Google's index today? The most recent data I could find is actually from 2016, so it's probably changed, grown a lot in the last 8 years, but going from 1998 to 2016, anyone want to guess? Let me get a couple guesses. How many pages are in there? 2 billion? A trillion? 25 what? 25 billion? It's 130 trillion. In 2016, it was reported that Google's index contained 130 trillion pages. That's roughly about 16,000 web pages per person on the planet that Google can index, that Google can rank. This doesn't happen if on day one, in 1998, when Google launches version one of this product, under the search bar, they say, index contains 25 million pages. We did it. We're the best. We nailed it. We're the best. Pat us on the backs. We just are awesome at search. But instead, they said, this is version one. We're going to get bigger and better. It's the same to our business. Everything we do, constant question, constantly look at everything that you've ever said, oh, that's just the way we do it. Go figure out why. Go figure out if you're still on version one of something that could be on version two. The other idea of this prioritized iteration and feedback comes back to this feedback idea. And it makes me think of a story that Tony Robbins used to tell. Tony Robbins, a famous motivational speaker. He's got this story where he says before he became Tony Robbins, the famous motivational speaker, he had a sales job. And he used to have to give sales pitches, sales presentations. And ironically, he was pretty bad at it. Always got really poor reviews, always got really bad ratings whenever he got scored presentations. But he's a very motivated guy, Tony Robbins, as you can imagine. So he goes to his boss and says, hey, boss, I want to get better at this. Could you send me out on three times as many sales presentations? Three times as many I want to do, because I'm going to nail this. So he does. And he goes out on presentation after presentation. He does. People come along. His boss reviews him. He gets scored. Does this for months. Come back. Says, boss, how am I doing? He looks at his scores. Exactly the same. Exactly the same. And says, that's when he realized, this is one of my favorite quotes of all time. Tony says, that's when I realized that practice doesn't make perfect. Practice makes consistent. Practice plus feedback makes perfect. And at Google, we were so incredibly focused on this idea of how much feedback we can get and how quickly can we get feedback. Let's not go through a process, let's not build a product without getting feedback along the way. Because the limit to how good we can make a thing is highly dependent on getting other smart brains involved and getting other ideas in the conversation. The whole idea of brainstorming always drove me crazy, but so many organizations I work with, they treat brainstorming as if it's like an individual thing, when it should be a team activity, when we should be sharing our thoughts out loud. And the Google's product I always think of with this is this one. Anybody know what these are? Anybody remember these? Google glasses? Anybody have a pair of Google glasses ever? Now, what? Do you guys remember Google glasses? You know what I'm talking about? This sounds like I'm just making this up. Okay, Google glasses came out in like 2011. Super cool. All the stuff you see now, like all that Apple Vision, whatever it's called, or Oculus Rift stuff, this is like the precursor. This is like the world's first big brand augmented reality, virtual reality project. It's this smart glasses, it's like turns you into a RoboCop, right? You got a little lens, you can interact with them, your voice, it can show you stuff in your lens, in front of your vision. Super cool. Obviously, it didn't do super well, because not one person in this room ever bought it. But that's okay. The cool thing about Google Glasses to me is that one day at Google, somebody walked into an engineering meeting at a team called Google X, which works on the big crazy stuff. And they said, hey, everybody, I think we should build like RoboCop goggles. I think we should build like smart augmented reality projection eyewear. That was pretty crazy in 2011. That was pretty out there. So here's my question to you, knowing how much Google prioritizes feedback and collaboration. How long do you think it took from the time that person said that to the time that team had a prototype that worked that you could actually wear? How long do you think it took? 2 weeks?
3 months.
3 months? One more?
8 months.
What was that?
8 months.
It took 45 minutes. This is the 45-minute version of Google Glasses. And it's absurd, right? He's like got a phone like glued to rapid call goggles. It's only like a book bag with wires coming out of it. But this was 45 minutes after they decided to try it. 45 minutes. You know why they did it in 45 minutes? Because they know that most big projects like that, most big inventions, most undertakings at most businesses, if somebody would have said that idea, they would have spent the next 2 years in their own little notebook, modeling it out and coming up with visuals. They would have done computer simulation after computer simulation, but instead, they said, I want everyone in this room to know what the heck I'm talking about. I want everyone in this room to understand, to be able to try my idea, to feel it, to touch it, to see it. Let's build it now so that we all collectively together can come up with version 2 and version 3 and version 4. And of course, it took months and years to get to one that's selling to the public. But as soon as possible, that put the idea out of their head and into a shared space of getting feedback so they could build new models, try things. One of the most important things with innovation is that willingness to share your thoughts, to get other people's thoughts, to not be afraid that, oh, my idea isn't perfect yet, let me keep it to myself. Oh, my idea might not be possible, it might not be realistic, it might be too expensive. Getting those ideas out of your head and seeing what it triggers in other people's minds, just like with Jeff Bezos, is so important. And so many businesses fail to do this. So many businesses look at the feedback they're getting, the data they're getting, the insights from consumers they're getting, and they ignore it for one reason or another, from stubbornness, from reluctance, from comfort, from saying, I'm comfortable with the way things are. This video I want to show you, this is, any baseball fans? Any Phillies fans? Some people's hands went down like aggressively quick when I said Phillies fan. That doesn't make any sense. There's 400 people here. Is that one Phillies fan? There we go. Okay, two. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to throw this down. I love baseball. So I've got some baseball fans in here. There's a clip from an actual Major League Baseball game from about 9 years ago, the Arizona Diamondbacks game. And these announcers, who are longtime baseball fans, former baseball players, former baseball coaches, notice some girls in the audience who are engaging with their product in a way that is unfamiliar to them. And I want to show you what was actually broadcasted on TV during this baseball game.
And I mean, look at the one on the right.
Do you have to make faces when you take selfies?
Wait, one more now.
Oh, really?
What are you?
That's the action I'll do.
Well, check it. Did that come out okay?
That's the best one of the 300 pictures I've taken of myself today.
Every girl in the picture is locked into her phone.
Wow.
Every single one is dialed in. Welcome to parenting in 2015. They're all just completely transfixed by the tech downloads.
Back to the
game. David Pearls.
Back to the girls.
Look, hold on, man. Take a selfie with the hot dog. Selfie with the churro. Selfie just of the selfie. I can't even get my phone to take pictures. Took a picture of your thumb last week. That was good.
Here's my first bite of the churro. Here's my second bite of the churro.
You know, the beauty of baseball is you can sit next to your neighbor and have a conversation, or you can just completely ignore them.
But this is the best line. God, I'm just
trying. Knocks it into center, David, tonight. 2-for-2, leadoff single here in the fourth. And nobody noticed.
And nobody noticed. Oh, that video. The price you were so awesome. So, I'm a big baseball fan. This is my opinion on Major League Baseball. You know what Major League Baseball doesn't need any more of? 60-year-old white men fans who have loved baseball for 50 years. You know what Major League Baseball really, really needs more of? 19-year-old girls who window baseball games. You know what Major League Baseball really, really needs more of? People that want to take pictures of baseball games and videos and put it on TikTok and Instagram. Every one of these girls bought a ticket. They all bought the super extensive concessions. A number of them are wearing baseball gear. These are fantastic customers. But to many people within Major League Baseball, and this happens at so many companies and so many organizations, this looks unfamiliar. And it looks weird and it looks different. So even though we're getting this data back from our consumers are telling us, this is how we want to engage with your product. This is how we want to engage with your business. It feels uncomfortable to us. We're not interested. We don't want to accept it. We think keep doing it our way, we'll be fine. This is the same thing that happened to Blockbuster and to Kodak and to taxi services. It's rare that that big crazy trend or that big new idea that takes someone out of business or ruins someone's industry or declines someone's industry comes out of nowhere, right? Usually we see it coming. Usually we see it coming, but we don't care enough to act. We're too stubborn to act. We're too stubborn to change. You don't think every taxi company in the world could have done what Uber did? You don't think they could have seen Uber coming and said, oh, let's start having our taxis pay through phones. Oh, let's start having our taxis have built-in GPSs. You don't think taxi companies could have done that? You don't think Kodak, who invented digital cameras in the 1980s, you don't think they could have beat Instagram to the punch? You don't think they could have beat all these digital cameras? Of course they could have. They saw it coming. They just said, this is unfamiliar to us. It's uncomfortable to us. We're not willing to change regardless of the feedback we're getting. And that is the death of innovation. When we have insights, we have ideas, we have data, and we say, eh, I'm just gonna keep doing what I'm doing because that's what I'm comfortable with. Because it's worked for me in the past, right? That's how we made money last year. That's how we made money when my dad ran the business. Last one, fuel curiosity and passion. Has anybody ever heard of 20% time at Google? Some people talk about this idea. A couple hands. Okay, so at Google we had this thing called 20% time. It was this idea, in theory, that every Google employee, although it was really aimed at engineers, but every employee at Google was supposed to be able to take 20% of their time, that's like one day a week, to work on whatever they wanted. Didn't have to have anything to do with your job, your team, your project. It was hard to execute practice, but a lot of people did it. And if Google's not the only one that does it. 3M has had 15% time at their company since the 80s, way before Google even existed. But it was this concept. It's very hard to follow. It's very hard for most businesses to do. It helps that Google has like infinite money, right? To let their employees just do whatever one day a week. But the philosophy behind it is really important. And it's a really valuable tool towards driving innovation that anyone can follow. And there's two reasons we do this. There's two reasons Google does this. The first, is the obvious one. If you let people work on the things they want to work on, the things they're curious about, the things they're passionate about, of course they're going to work harder. Of course they're going to bring more of themselves. Of course they're going to try anything and just put all of themselves into the work. That's obvious, working on things you like. But the second idea was really, really important too, and it's this idea of collaboration. So in a company like Google, what we do is we give people the opportunity to voice those things. Tell us what you like. Tell us what you're interested in. Tell us what you're curious about. Post it on these 20% project forums, these message boards. And when that happens, people find each other. So let's say there's some woman who works on the YouTube team and loves fantasy football. And she says, I think we at Google should build a fantasy football app. She posts it, and then somebody from the Android team says, oh, I love fantasy football too. Let me work with you on that. And so does somebody from HR, and somebody from search, and someone from hardware, and someone from software, and someone from engineering, and someone from finance. And now we've got this team of people trying to build this fantasy football app, and you hope it works, and you hope it's this great project and this great product. But even if it's not, when the project is over, and all these people go back to their team, suddenly the Android team knows all these cool new tools and strategies that the YouTube team uses. The finance team teaches the HR team about some new function, some new website, some new platform. This collaboration of people who usually don't come together is really valuable. And anybody can mirror that, anyone can copy that. And at Google, it's led to some really cool stuff. My favorite ever 20% project, probably, or one of the ones I think is the coolest, is this one. Does anybody know what this is? Do you know what it's called? You're imaging it right. It was good charades, you did good charades. It's called Google Cardboard. It was a sheet of perforated cardboard with two glass discs in it. What happened was there were two guys at Google who said, hey, I think virtual reality is the future. I think augmented reality is the future. But right now, the only way to access virtual reality is through like a $2,000 Oculus Rift. This is like in 2011. We think that means that underprivileged communities are going to fall behind. We think the future of education is virtual reality, and underprivileged school districts are not going to have access to this stuff because it's $1,000 for one unit. How can we do that better? So they found a way to invent with just a perforation of cardboard and two glass discs, a do-it-yourself virtual reality. Like you slide your phone into this slot in the front, you hold it up to your face, and you move around, and you've got virtual reality. Something that Google could give away for free. It barely costs anything. There's some really cool uses of this, and probably the coolest use of this was when this girl was born in a Minnesota hospital. Her name was Tegan, and she was born missing one of her lungs and with only half of a heart, and she was sent home from the hospital to die. Because this isn't gonna have a sad ending, so don't get too, obviously I'm not gonna tell a sad story. She was sent home from the hospital to die because the surgeon said that's not something that we could fix. No one's ever done that. We don't know how to do that. We can't fix that. Her parents frantically looked for some surgical center that would try to help her. They sent her case to hundreds of different hospitals. They were in Minnesota, and finally they got in front of a hospital down in Miami that had a really innovative surgical center. They read the case aloud at their like weekly review of new cases. And in the coincidence of all coincidences, and you can watch the 60-minute video on this, I'm not making it up, someone on that team had just been gifted a Google Cardboard by, I think it was their niece or nephew. They had it sitting on their desk. And they said, you know what? If everyone in the operation, everyone involved, could actually look at a diagram, three-dimensional image of the heart, we could all look at it together and plan out how this surgery would happen. Maybe we could do this. Maybe we could save this girl. And they did. Because two guys at Google were given a little free time to go play around with a sheet of cardboard. Oh, but that's not the first time people have clapped for that story. I mean, it is a cool story. And it's a very warm and fluffy story, but of course I'm also talking about giving your employees a day a week to do whatever they want. It'd be nice if, you know, that kid was some money. Other famous 20% projects include Gmail and Google Maps. Fortune estimates that Google Maps makes about $12 billion a year. Came from people given free time. Gmail in particular, great story about Gmail, we always talk about at Google. Somebody went and pitched Larry and Sergey, they're founders of Google, on building Gmail. They said, I think we could build an email browser that would be better than all the others. Larry Page, one of the smartest people in the world, famously said, no, why would we do that? There's so many email browsers already, why would we need another? You know what that guy said? Well, I've got 20% of my time. I'll just go do it myself, and I'll see if anybody else wants to help me. And he built the most popular email system in the world, making Google billions and billions of dollars. These two pay for every other 20% project 100 times over, no problem. Finding opportunities for people to pursue the things they care about, learning the things that your employees and your teams care about, letting them collaborate, letting them connect with other people is incredibly valuable. So that's my three principles. Look for innovation everywhere. Prioritize iteration and feedback and fuel curiosity and passion. But if you take nothing else away, come back to this idea of not knowing what the future holds. Does this look like Wilmington in this picture? So I did like an AI image generator, and I typed in, give me an image of futuristic Wilmington, North Carolina, with time machines and rocket ships, and this is what I got. Because I'm trying new things. I'm trying to use these AI tools and ChatGPT and all that stuff. So again, I'll just say the same thing I said at the beginning, which is you truly can't know what's possible. No one can. Get away from trying to predict the future, and none of us can do it. But you have to embrace that that doesn't just go for this kind of stuff. It truly goes for everything you do. And I keep using that example of like how you send emails or how you hold meetings. It's a very real way to think about your business, is to say, just because no one has come up with the version 2 yet, just because no one has come up with a better way to do this yet, just because we've done it for 5 years, it doesn't mean that there isn't one. It doesn't mean that it's not worth questioning, that it's not worth thinking about, that it's not worth brainstorming on. Innovation is a very powerful tool, and it's an easy tool if you put effort into it, and you put time into it, and you bring people together to accomplish it. Last thing I'll say, feel free to reach out anytime. I'm gonna go hang out somewhere in this room, come grab me if you want to talk. I love traveling around and doing this and getting to tell stories, but I also love doing this because I get to hear other people's stories. I've never even been to Wilmington, North Carolina before. Maybe let's just come tell me about their business and their work in this city. I would love to learn more. So reach out anytime, and thank you all for the time. I appreciate it.
All right, so I would like to introduce Mike Brown, Senior Vice President of Cape Fear Commercial. I'm now going to call for a motion to elect Mike Brown to the position of the Treasurer of Board of Directors because the nominating committee has recommended Mike for the position of Treasurer. All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion carries. This means that Mike will eventually be the chair of the Chamber of Commerce. I can't quite do the math, but maybe somebody else can in some years. So congrats, Mike. Now the nominating committee proposes for 2023 to 2025 this class of appointees to include Christy Hubbard, Novant Health. Wonderful. Thank you. Nicholas Montoya, Blackhaven Runner Beach Resort. Rob Kaiser, Wilmington Media and Marketing. Ted Shipley, Live Oak Bay. Also, he was my leadership Wilmington class. And Lily Loazzo of GE Hitachi, who's not with us tonight. So I will now call for a motion to elect these appointees. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, the motion carries. Congratulations. I would also like to introduce the following new members as approved by the Board of Directors for one-year appointments. Tyrone Garrett with the Wilmington Housing Authority. Sean Olson with Cloudwise. Riley Stevenson with Rockefeller Capital Management. Okay, he's not with us tonight. And Chris Ainsworth with Encino, also not here. But congratulations to them, and also to the 2024 chairman's appointees made by Lisa Leaf, Alexis Hunter with Wilmington Health, and Mark Skiffer with Salt Air Heating and Cooling, who's also not here as well. So finally, I'd like to present to you the executive committee, which consists also of Lily Lazo, who is not here. She is the chair of the personnel committee. Shakima Clinton Quintana, who serves as our at-large member of the executive committee. Mike Brown, who will act as the treasurer and the chair of the finance committee. Nicholas Montoya, who will serve as the second vice chair and the chair of membership development. Jim Hunley, who will serve as the first vice chair and chair of the public policy committee. Lisa Leith, who will serve as the chair of the Wilmington Board of Directors. And Natalie English, the president and CEO of the Wilmington Chamber of Commerce. Okay, Lisa, come on up. It's time for me to hand you the gavel. All right. So it's time for you to take the wheel of the Wilmington Chamber of Commerce and the gavel as well. So I'm really excited to hand this off to you. And if you need anything, you know where to find me. And I'm really excited for you, so don't go far. Cheers to a great year. Thank you.
I want to thank Stephanie. Can everybody give her a giant round of applause? Stephanie is an incredible volunteer in this community. Like, all the people on the stage are volunteers, and we're just very grateful for the time that you put in to the chamber. I'm the HR person on the stage, but Stephanie wrote like all the job descriptions for every person on the executive committee, which was dear to my heart. And she's also put a lot of process into what it takes and just basic board expectations and guidelines for us, which is going to make it all the better in the future years to come at the chamber. So I appreciate you, and thanks for being a friend.
You're so welcome. Cool. Now we have to take this picture.
Okay. I mean, we're dying to do this.
Will, where are you? We have to get this.
No, we're not. Yes. Get out of here. Okay.
Yes. Okay. All right, you got to hold it. She's the boss now. Very good.
Hey, look, cheers.
Thanks.
Cheers to you.
All right. And now the board can leave with me, and we're going to leave you in charge.
Great. And I please thank the board members for their volunteer services. Welcome.
Okay.
For those of you who don't know me, my name is Lisa Leith. As Stephanie said, I am the 2024 board chair of the Wilmington Chamber of Commerce. I am also the chief people officer at Mantica, the software company headquartered here in Wilmington. We're proud of that. And I'm looking forward to serving as the board chair. Personally, I mentioned I'm an HR person, and I'm very passionate about growing talent here in the Wilmington region, but also retaining talent is something that we've got to be really concerned with. Throughout my career, just to give you a little bit of background on me, I've held a bunch of diverse human resources related leadership positions, whether it be at Corning, Alchemy, Vantica, and then I started a business, an HR consulting firm called Leith HR Group, which my husband now runs. And across all those different experiences, I've actually been able to touch roughly 15,000 regional employees. So I'm pretty proud of that. As a career HR professional, I'm thrilled about the North Carolina State's legislature. I mentioned it in the video, but we got $2.8 million. Yeah, I mean, like, for the Career Leadership Development Academy, which is under Laura Brogdon Primavera's guidance, and she's so awesome, guys. We're really lucky to have this entire staff, but for sure, Laura. So this CLDA, that's the acronym for it, if you see it in Natalie's newsletters, is meant to equip middle school students, seventh graders in particular, which there's a lot of research that shows if you can get to seventh graders and introduce them to different careers, that's the time where they start exploring other options and their mind is open to things that they're not introduced to at home. It introduces them to career pathways and essential leadership skills too, which we all know is really important. And it's led by, influenced by our local job market. So she's constantly looking for additional input from the employers in the area, which I think is awesome. So what started with 40 students 2 years ago and a generous commitment from Truist Foundation, which I want to say thank you, thank you, thank you to Charlie and the team at Truist. Can we please give them a round of applause? Is now going to expand to, think about it, $2.8 million. We had 40, then we had 80 kids. How many seventh graders do you think that we are going to put through this program this year? Anybody, shout it out.
1,728.
That's right, Laura, thank you. 1,728 seventh graders. And that's going to kick off later this August. So we're really, really proud of this program. So I am delighted to introduce you to a couple of kids that are going through or just actually recently finished the program. Two participants, their names are Ace and Deslid. Please give them a warm welcome to the stage. They're going to tell us a little bit about their experience.
We're tossed out being like these autos. It's such a move. Can you change from the onto the leader?
Hey, what's up, Deslid? How you doing?
Hey, I'm doing good. Good to see you too, Ace. Can you believe it's almost been a year since we graduated from the Career and Leadership Development Academy? Isn't that crazy?
Yes, and now we're doing the program for a second year as mentors and taking the stage at the largest Chamber of Commerce meeting. How are you feeling about that?
I'm feeling pretty good. I've talked in front of groups, but definitely not in front of a group this big before.
How about we use those power skills we learned and talk to everyone here about the Career Leadership Development Academy and our experiences?
Sounds good. Let's do it.
All right. After going on all 8 industry exploration trips, which one was your favorite?
For me, it would definitely be the manufacturing and engineering field trips, just because I come from a family of engineers, so that's always been the career path I've always wanted to go down. What about you, Ace?
Probably when we went to Dark Horse Studios for film day, because we got to experience special effects and got to walk the red carpet.
Awesome. What about the 8th grade mentor program, and how do you feel about that and being able to work with the 7th graders over at Holly Shelter?
I'm really excited that they got to go, that I got to see what they went through. They got to see what I did last year and to see the final presentation. How's it going with your 7th graders?
It's going good. I'm especially excited to see them go through the final presentation because that was personally one of my favorite parts of it.
Awesome. How will we use some of those social skills we learned and how we use them every day?
I would definitely say social skills because not everybody can come up here and just talk to a bunch of people they've never met before. I would definitely say that the CLDA program has definitely helped all of us out with being able to talk to new people and be able to, you know, do stuff like this. So
mine were probably adaptability because we use that every single day and communication because we have to constantly talk to people and get our ideas across.
Nice. I'm just glad that we got to experience the CLDA program and now be in the 8th grade mentor program. And now I get to go to Ashley High School and see how I can bring engineering into my future career. What about you, Ace? What high school do you think you'll be going
to? I'm actually going to a high school out of county where CLDA doesn't exist yet. I'm so excited to take the skills I learned into my next year.
Sounds good. Good job, Ace.
Thanks. You too, Desmond.
Thank you.
Come on, they're awesome. Just think that these two were two of 80 kids, and we're going to put 1,728 kids through this program. It's going to be awesome. We need your help. So if you want to be an employer volunteer, please talk to Laura Brogdon Primavera. We're going to need a lot more employers to volunteer their space, their time, and their energy to these kids starting in August. So thank you in advance. Okay, so as the board chair in 2024, I'm actively seeking opportunities to further enhance the chamber's success in talent, retention, development, and attraction. So, one significant milestone occurred in August of 2023. We hired a VP of Talent Pipeline with an initial focus on the healthcare sector in southeastern North Carolina. We better get a giant round of applause for this, because thanks to a generous $22.3 million investment from the New Hanover Community Endowment to UNCW, Cape Fear Community College, and the Wilmington Chamber of Commerce, our region is strategically positioned to address critical workforce needs in healthcare in New Hanover County. And this investment is going to concentrate on the recruitment, training, and retention of healthcare professionals dedicated to serving this community. $22.3 million. Raise your hand if you have heard about nccareercoast.com. Okay, it's about 30% of the room. I want the other 70% to jot this down, nccareercoast.com. We are expanding this NC Career Coast brand and website to reach a wider audience of job seekers that might want to move here. We want to be able to target digital ads on behalf of our local regional employers and engage social media to really activate this platform. But we're aiming to generate meaningful job opportunities for the region's employers, particularly in the high demand fields identified by New Hanover County for growth. Communities like ours are increasingly adopting new strategies to attract the talent needed for continued growth. We've been benchmarking for years. I don't know if you guys remember the economic scorecard that we used to put together. I love being on that committee. But we've been benchmarking places like Charleston, Savannah, Greenville, South Carolina, Chattanooga, Tennessee. And those cities are actively running talent attraction campaigns to support their regional employers. I am grateful that our leadership team at the Wilmington Chamber is thinking about this kind of stuff and having a vision, getting involved proactively and early to ensure we stay in the game. We definitely are growing, and we need people to fill our jobs. Speaking of growth and evolution, I want to remind folks that we're facing another round of elections this year, and so we're going to be tempted to tune the noise out, but I am asking you and encouraging you all to pay attention to the candidates that are out there. We really want to elect candidates who prioritize policies that promote economic development, support entrepreneurship, and support our schools, and foster a business-friendly environment so we can create a thriving economy for all people. It's critical we stay engaged in the process. As a reminder, our primary elections are March 5th, and I look forward to seeing you there. The Chamber's going to continue to collaborate and liaise with the government. We have to focus on addressing pressing issues like infrastructure. We mentioned the bridge, and we all feel the pain there. But workforce training, access to resources, business community needs to continue growing. By working together, we can find great solutions to address these challenges and build a resilient economy. So finally, this is fun. We do an inner city visit every single year. Last year we went to Fort Lauderdale. We learned a lot. The best part was the relationships that grew on the buses to each little field trip that we took. This year we are going on an inner city visit to Savannah, Georgia. And we're going in May, and that's going to provide our community's leaders, some of you, I hope, will join us to learn from our peer city, Savannah. Overall, this trip is going to be enriching. I mentioned the relationships. That's awesome. But we learned about how small business and infrastructure and the entrepreneurship community actually work in a peer city. We're going to come back with lots of fresh perspectives after learning from our Savannah counterparts. I'm thrilled. I hope you join us if you can. But lastly, I am deeply grateful. I am honored. I am so thankful to follow in the footsteps of Stephanie and other people that have held the board chair seat. And I'm very thankful that I have been chosen for this role in 2024. So I want to introduce you to Aaron Penny from Lumos. You see their truck over there, but these guys are making a giant investment in our community. They're putting $56 million to build 655 miles of fiber. Yay. They're doing this with the highest technology in optical fiber in Wilmington and Carolina Beach. So please welcome them to the stage. I'd like you to turn your Lumos lights on. You've got little fiber optic flashlights. And let's give them a fun Wilmington welcome. Tap them on the table. Come on now, give them a drum roll. Aaron, come on up with your team.
Let's
welcome Lumos to the stage.
Green faded.
Mayor Bill Sato and Commissioner Bill Biden here. Are you out there? Please come out.
Here you go, Mom.
What are you rubbing on? Oh, one of them is my sister. She's looking close to the very end. What about you? You don't feel warm. I can feel the magic. Can we do it here?
What is it?
The impotent needs pretty good kid. In my...
In fact, in deep discipline, be it.
Thank you so much. Wow, what an evening. I'm going to need some help from those two young adults that did so well talking publicly, because this is not my forte. I'm much more better in the corner by one of these corners, actually. But first of all, we really appreciate Wilmington. Really appreciate Natalie and her entire team. 157 consecutive years. You reminded me consecutive earlier. Let's give it up for the Chamber one more time. That's a national thing. You're talking about surpassing business in World War II, the Great Depression. This community's business industry never stopped. That is something to be extremely proud of. And every trip that our team has had the opportunity to attend meetings here over the past year, we've heard about new infrastructure, we've heard about new investments, new businesses, and just new exciting opportunities that are coming to this area. It was easy for Lumos to select Wilmington as an area that we wanted to come in and invest. And in April 23, we invested and committed a $56 million infrastructure to build out state-of-the-art fiber optic internet that would speed so fast, I don't even know what we do about it. We learned a lot about Google earlier. I don't know what, if we can travel space yet through our fiber optics, but we gotta figure out more than Netflix, because there's a lot of bandwidth coming to Wilmington. One fact that I'll leave you with is 655 miles can take you all the way up to New Haven, Connecticut. It can take you past Nashville, Tennessee. It can take you south of Tampa, Florida. And that infrastructure is going to be within the city limits and county of New Hanover County, Carolina Beach, and Wilmington. We thank you all for your time. We're grateful to be here, and please be sure to see our team tonight.
Why run the internet when you can rebuild it? The internet as we know it today was built for the last 50 years, when landlines ruled and cable TV was the future. And that's why it's time for the internet as we don't know it. Where small cities have internet as fast as big cities, where uploads are as fast as downloads, where your digital life is never interrupted. And the metaverse isn't just a concept, but a part of life. We're building 100% fiber optic internet from the ground up, an internet built for the communities where we all live, work, thrive, and grow. An internet built for small businesses that want to make a big impact. An internet built for families with smartphones, video games, voice assistants, tablets, nanny cams, robot vacuums, and everything in between. All online, all at the same time. This is the internet built for that most hopeful of all things, the future. Because whatever the future holds, Lumos makes it faster. Lumos, internet built for the future.
So how about that, you guys? I know you're ready to go. I hope you've had a good time tonight. We really wanted to make this an entertaining opportunity to celebrate all that we've done in 23, what we look forward to doing in 24 and beyond. And so first I'd like to thank First National Bank and Lumos for your presenting sponsorships. It's awesome. Thank you very much. And all the other sponsors and table sponsors, thank you. Without you guys, we couldn't do things like this. We couldn't have this much fun, and we couldn't impact the business community without your investment. Also, I want to thank
my good buddy Will Page with Will Page Photography and Will Page Productions, and Megan Mullins, Chief Communications, Marketing and Communications Officer at the Wilmington Chamber of Commerce for our Barbie film. How amazing was that? We had a lot of fun making it, and I'll tell you, I saw the movie a couple of times, and if you didn't, you might not know this, but you've probably heard the Billie Eilish song, What Was I Made For? And in the movie, Barbie wasn't sure what she was made for. I can tell you 100% I know what I was made for. I was made for this work. I was made to be a part of a team to make positive impact on my community, and I love what I get to do. I love that I get to work with people, I get to help build partnerships, and I get to help see the future possibilities in our community. So when it comes to partnerships, we get to partner with our elected officials. And so for a quick moment, I'd like to recognize those who are here. And I'm pulling out my phone because I do not want to miss any. I call him Santa Claus lately, but Senator Michael Lee is in the house. We also have all of our county commissioners. So Commission Chairman Bill Reitenbach, Commission Vice Chair Leanne Pierce, we have Commissioner Jonathan Barfield, Commissioner Dane Scalise, and Commissioner Rob Zappel. Thank you guys for being here. We also have, as you saw, Mayor Bill Sappo, and other representatives of the City of Wilmington are Mayor Pro Tem Clifford Barnett, as well as Council Members David Joyner and Celeste Andrews. Thank you guys for joining us. And then from our school board, we have Stephanie Craybill and Josie Barnhart, really big partners of ours as well on COVA. Thank you all for being here and being with us. So those partnerships that I mentioned, partnerships, people, and possibilities, the partnerships are critical. We work with our elected officials and their staffs to make sure that we are working towards a better future in our community. We work with other not-for-profit organizations to make sure that where they see opportunity, that we are helping them in whatever way that might look like. We're partnering with our education institutions to ensure that we are developing the talent pipeline for you today and tomorrow and 10 years from now. We believe that's critically important to your success. And those partnerships will continue, and there are some we don't even know about yet. When it comes to people, I know, you guys know this, and I think a lot of corporate taglines, it's the people, right? Because it is. And you guys can't be successful without people. We can't be successful without people. I am truly grateful to the people who serve in our board of directors, who serve in leadership positions on our councils and committees, who serve as our ambassadors. I'd also like to, it was not in the script, so it's not her fault, but we do have one new board member. You might have seen him on stage, but his name wasn't read. He was elected a little bit later than the others because he's new to our community, and that's Uri Bovio with Novant New Haven Regional Medical Center. So, Uri, welcome to the team. The people to me that are the most important are the team of professionals, right, that I get to work with every single day. Megan, Josh, Stephen, Laura, Gina, April, Haven, Gray, Kristen, and Billy. Here are some of our newest team members. You guys, they are unbelievably at the jobs that they do individually, but when you put them on air, I promise you, second to none, there's not another chamber team in the United States that's better than that chamber team, and I am honored to work with them every day. Thank you for helping me take them. Finally, it's about possibilities, right? I hope Steve got you motivated to think creatively and innovatively about how we continue to do amazing things in Wilmington, because we've got resources that are unique. And they're not just our natural resources, right? We've got an endowment that is poised to make amazing impact in our community, and it's going to require all of us to work together to make that impact. And so I encourage you to keep thinking about the possibilities we are just now starting to realize, like Project Brace. Who's excited about that? I know I am, right? Think about the possibilities that have come with our Riverfront Park and the pool concerts. Did anybody hear Dirk's Bentley's coming? Guess where I'll be that night, right? Listening to Dirk's getting drunk on a plane. The other possibilities that we know are coming are the possibilities that come with the opportunity that we have to develop around Skyline Center. You know, we used to call it the PPD building. We tried to call it the Thermo Fisher building, but we need to call it Skyline Center because that's what it is. It is owned by our city. There are plots of land around Skyline Center that are going to give us an opportunity to potentially create a bigger convention district, but economic development at the core of that. We have the opportunity also with that purchase to work with our city and Wellington Downtown Inc. to look at what does Chestnut Street and Third Street look like with those properties that are hopefully going to be in private hands in the near future, not only for the redevelopment purpose that they provide, but also to keep our taxes low, right? Because they intend to pay off that debt with that. They will pay off that debt with the sale of those properties. So other possibilities also refer back to our partnerships, and that is around economic development. Wellington Business Development, Wellington Downtown Inc., Brunswick BID, and Josh Hallensey, who manages the small business retention, expansion, and attraction work at the Chamber. They are attracting jobs, y'all. Josh has met with over 100 businesses this year. A couple dozen of those are adding jobs. They're expanding their footprint. They're spending money in our region and employing our people. Those are the possibilities that will continue because you all care enough to invest in your community and to continue to support the work of the Chamber and all of our partners across the community. I hope you've had a good time tonight. I really hope that you understand we are passionate about helping you grow your business, about making our economy the best economy, continuing to grow, and about this being, as Wilma said, the best place to live in America. So please have a great night. Thank you so much for being here, and we'll see you soon.